was diagnosed with prostate cancer with a PSA, I believe it was 4,000 or may have been as high as 6,000. And I stopped off at their house and we went over his helpline medical form. And he actually responded dramatically to therapy and his PSA went to undetectable. And Jan was such an avid partner that I ended up hiring her for the PCRI, but Florida, the East Coast division. And she has been absolutely incredible. She is so smart and sharp. What I'm looking for is a way to translate what I'm trying to teach you and others teach you into your actual care, because all of what I'm doing here is worthless unless we can actually turn it into something that you can do. If we can find some docs out here, because I can't do it. I'm overloaded right now, I think. I can't do it, even long distance. But if we can find either a group or a physician that we can help that doctor with a really enlightened layperson or nurse practitioner, then we could deliver wonderful care to a lot of you. Not to all of you, but to a lot of you. So I wanted to run that by you. The other possibility is to try to re-interest Cancer Treatment Centers of America to develop a prostate cancer dedicated facility in Chicago, out here, and to find a medical oncologist that can at least interact with me via phone or email to help bring up your level of care. We tried to do that a long time ago, it didn't work out. So those were two thoughts. Any feedback from you regarding those considerations?
About the Cancer Center of America, was that Dr. Granick you were interacting with before?
Well, you know, am I on camera right now? I don't want to be sued for anything.
I'll turn it off.
I tried to work with Joel, but he did not have the passion. I think he had the compassion, but he didn't have the passion, and he didn't have the real true dedication to prostate cancer. And I expressed that to the people at CTCA, the higher-ups. Okay. We need to find somebody that, you know, has the same sense of when you do good, they feel good. We need to find someone like that.
Have you met a radiologist named Dr. Eden there?
Dr.
Eden? Eden?
No.
I just wanted to find someone.
No. I mean, this is now practical stuff, and this really, really relates to how much are you interested in facilitating your own care, even if it means making a contribution financially, not to the MD, but to some paramedical people. See, the big problem is when you're in a practice and you're doing good and you're busy, you can't keep up that quality of care. You need additional help. If you hire another doctor, it's extremely costly. It's a huge amount of expense for overhead. If you hire a paramedical person, like a nurse practitioner or a physician's assistant, it becomes more doable. If I ever went back into practice, which I could possibly do, but I don't think so, I would probably train a number of nurse practitioners or physician's assistants. With the same philosophy and same strategy to educate and to facilitate all your care, and that's what I think that you should consider doing with a person or persons that you could identify that really care. The caring is a big component. So back in the days of the early days of this country, when the pioneers moved west, when they were in small towns and they needed a doctor or a dentist, they advertised and they paid for that doctor or dentist to come out to their town. And that's how they got their medical care. And I'm suggesting that you folks consider using some of your treasury to hire, and it wouldn't cost that much money, a Jan Mannery type person, a Deborah Navarre, who is the daughter of a patient in Michigan. I mean, that gal within 1 month was as sharp as any of the, almost as sharp as many of the doctors that I know who've been in this field for years. Does that ring any kind of feeling in you that this is something that you would be willing to consider?
Doctor, I certainly would speak personally to the qualifications, the passion, and the help that Jan has given me. And to be able to find someone like her for this area, I think would be remarkable.
Thank you. Okay. Okay, so you've had, thank you for even bringing that to my attention. Have any of you had contact other than this gentleman with Jan Manarit in Florida? Just Russ and you, really?
So there's one other party, I think.
Have any of you called the PCRI helpline and spoke to Harry Pinchot? That's it? Three people? Four people? There's a bunch of talent out there that you're not using to help you. I'm just one person. I know my limitations, okay? But there are people out there that can help you. Bill and I came into contact with Deb Navarre. I don't even know if she's interested. Her dad presented with really bad advanced aggressive disease. This gal is really sharp. She's in Michigan. I don't think she would move, but she could be a huge resource. But if we can train people in a short period of time to be this smart, like Jan, that's a huge way to help you. If they were working with a doctor, and the doctor's orders were transmitted through people like that, we elevate your care gigantically.
Should we, along with what's happening, and you saw the show of hands here, I mean, we can't be calling you, and a number of the other of us that are just buried, should we be even just setting up more information for people in our group even to just say when they've got a lot of questions, I mean, we tell them a couple of sources, but maybe we should be recommending that they call PCRI and talk to Harry or talk to Jan or one of the others. Is that...
That's a better than this present situation partial answer, but the real, you know, after 25 years, the real problem is taking your situation, clarifying it, and then translating it into actual hands-on care. And some of your docs locally are overwhelmed with numbers of patients, and you're not getting what you should be getting. And the only way that I can see a resolution, okay, is by finding them talented help that they can afford in today's world of medicine, where Medicare reimbursements for oncologists have just gone down the tubes. We need to facilitate the caregiver's ability to give you care. And you're part of that equation if you want that. You can either sign up for an HMO and get even lousier care in general, or you can try to find the dedicated physicians and support them with paramedical people. That's one of my considerations that for you to answer your problems. Because you're getting smarter and more educated is not the answer. You're just going to get educated and frustrated. You will have eaten from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. And you'll be now aware that you're standing there naked. You know? What you want is to be able to eat from the tree of knowledge and go forward with that knowledge. So you have to really make some commitments.
My concern as a self-pay prostate cancer patient is...
Here, wait a minute.
My concern as a self-pay prostate cancer patient is I've not identified physicians in the Chicago area that I want to lay in the lap of and work with exclusively. So I've explored a little from here, a little from there, from you, Dr. Bark, and UCSF, and some other resources. So when you're saying have a paramedical trained to work with a physician dedicated here, I can't in conscience commit to that because I don't have a physician locally that I would say yes, this individual is on the same wavelength as I am.
I hear you, and I understand exactly what you're saying. But we have to start getting practical in terms of, hey, when I was in LA, I would be sending my patients wherever there was talent. I referred a lot of my patients from LA to San Francisco. I referred a lot of them when Dr. Bond was with Dr. Lee to Michigan. I referred a lot of them, and still do, to Florida, or to Sloan Kettering, or to Cleveland, to Pat Capellian, who's now in Tampa. So you go where the artist is. But if we could identify someone that would meet our expectations regarding caring and conscientiousness, or if we could create a dialogue with with Bob Mayo from Bob Mayo, one of the higher ups of CTCA. They would bring in an oncologist that would meet with my approval, for example. I am, believe me, I'm very, very strict regarding. I'm super critical. I mean, that's a downside, but that's for a patient. That's an upside. Would that? I mean, I hear what you're saying, but would that be something that would be tenable if the person, the doctor that you were to meet, was someone that you all loved? It ain't me, by the way. It's not me.
We tried that before, and we thought it was going to be him, but it wasn't.
What happened before was CTCA, and to be very brief, wanted me to start up a prostate cancer center in the Midwest, and I agreed, but I said I'd only do it if you would hire a medical oncologist, a young guy, that I could share my knowledge with, so that he would be able to have at least 20, 30 years of being able to devote his talent and train other people. So what did they do? They brought over this guy who turned out to be the son of the president of CTCA, who was interested not just in prostate cancer, but obstetrics, gynecology, pediatrics. And he, being the son of the president, he really wasn't interested in learning. You know, youth and knowledge, you can't teach any young person about things that you've learned the hard way. And maybe we were that way when we were younger. But that didn't work out. But maybe it's worth revisiting as a possible solution. It's a big organization, some very talented people in it. Because I don't see how I can really, truly help all of you at the level that you want.
Question.
Yeah.
Assume for the moment that we are able to come up with the funds required to hire a person on a yearly basis. Also assume that we have a sponsor or a source for their employment. Where would the education take place?
We would need to find somebody that could tutor, if they're not already fairly well trained, someone that we could tutor and interact with in terms of communication, be it email, phone, fax, until they got to the level where we felt that they were a standalone.
When you say we, who is we?
Well, certainly, I certainly would volunteer pro bono a lot of my time to do that. Not the majority of my time, but a lot of my time. That was what I was willing to do before, although I was going to be a salary part of CTCA. I don't want to move from where I am. I'm happy in Oregon. Okay. I have my own practice right now, and I have very, very strict requirements for patients, and I'm about close to saturation in terms of any new patients. So I take very few new patients. So this is not about me. It's about trying to figure out a way to help many of you. I don't think we're talking about a lot of money for a paramedical person. Probably, I imagine we're talking about $60,000 a year, maximum. There was a guy that used to work with me, a pharmacist. Boy, was he wonderful. John McDermott is his name. Do any of you know John? We couldn't afford to keep him on at PCRI, so I found him a job with DPC Laboratories. He's becoming a huge, huge part of that company. But that's the kind of person I love, a pharmacologist that cares about people, or an ordinary layperson. Anyway, we better get moving along.
Okay, you want to answer some questions? Okay, there's two of them that are related here. What is the cost of doing the lymph node tests and then with Comedex and the Netherlands?
Okay, it's Comedex. Comedex in the U.S., even though it's not approved, it's called Cinerum in Europe. And it's about 2,000 euros, which is probably about what now? No, the dollar isn't that weak. It's getting there, but not that weak. So I think it's about 20% now. I think a euro is about $1.20. So it's around 2,000 to 2,500, something like that.
Okay, there was another question related to it. Dr. Strum, speaker last night said that, or it was Dr. Moran, spoke two radiologists at the meeting in this past week. How many of the 30,000 of these did he really reach? And what was their reaction to his test?
Dr. Berens gave multiple presentations, and I would estimate that there probably were, he probably reached a couple hundred of the 30,000 people that were there, probably only a couple hundred, that were focused on prostate cancer. All the people that were there were radiologists from all over the world. And he's published a number of papers, and he lectures all over the world as well, Dr. Berens. And the second part of your question was what?
How many of them did they reach, and what was their reaction to his presentation?
I think that the reaction to the presentations was that everyone was duly impressed, and that they were, the U.S.-based doctors were obviously frustrated that they don't have this. Remember, it's only a contrast material. It's not the MRI machine. That's there already. No. We already have the oven, it's just that we don't have the gas to make the oven light.
They won't let us turn the gas on.
Yeah.
Another testing question, what about RTC-PCR as a marker for cancer outside of the prostate?
The RT-PCR blood test gets down basically to RNA testing, and there's a problem with that in terms of reproducibility, which is more of a laboratory issue. It will be a big part of the future of medicine. Right now, it's only being done really in an investigation type of setting in terms of research. The Germans actually are doing this. There's actually a company called BioFocus in Germany that's actually taking blood from patients with cancer and isolating tumor cells and on the blood doing chemosensitivity testing. They're also doing molecular markers. I'm going to pull that up for you to show you where that is. There's some doctors in New York City that are, this is BioFocus, Molecular Oncology Products and Services. I could email this to you, Russ, if you're interested, and you could then decide if you want to put it in a hot sheet or in a communication.
Okay.
So we've had some patients from the U.S. send their blood off to Germany, overnight express, and they analyze the blood, they look for prostate cells, and they actually do various tests against chemotherapy drugs and other molecular markers to manipulate the tumor cell. Let me give you an example so you understand what that means. We can do the same thing with tissue from prostate cancer that they're doing with blood. We have ways to test prostate cancer tissue to see if certain enzymes that, whether there are certain enzymes that are overly expressed by the cancer. For example, there's one enzyme called FAS, fatty acid synthase, which is the enzyme that converts carbohydrates into fatty acids. That's overly expressed in prostate cancer. Especially aggressive prostate cancer. In fact, John Epstein published a paper years ago that if you stained the prostate cancer tissue and found a lot of FAS, you had an aggressive prostate cancer. Well, now we have products, medicines, already on the market that are inhibitors of FAS. And guess what they're used for? Anyone? They're used for weight reduction and to treat diabetes. They're blocking carbohydrate being transformed into fatty acids. So one of them is available by prescription. It's called Xenical, X-E-N-I-C-A-L. So if we took a patient, for example, this gentleman, and we stained his tissue for FAS and it came back 3+ positive, we said, okay, his tissue is overly making this enzyme. Let's inhibit it. Change his diet. Get him off the carbohydrates and put him on Xenical. There is published literature on the use of Xenical in the treatment of prostate cancer, human prostate cancer. There are already papers published on this. So that's the kind of thing that we're not utilizing that's already out there. There's already literature, but the incorporation of these new advances, I mean, we're living in an exciting time right now. What's not good about it is we're not taking those exciting developments and transferring them into your care. as much as we should. Was that the full question?
Yes. Okay. All right. The next one was for lifelong maintenance, please advise the best set of supplements.
Okay. This really is spelled out on the PCRI website in a PCRI Insights newsletter. I think it's from 1999. I'm going to actually pull it up right now so you can see that. Let me go into my coaching file. Let's see. Important papers. Let's go into nutrition. Let's go into, just to complete that one other thought, let's go into and let me pull up this paper just to show you this. This is a PDF file. How many of you out there know what a PDF file is? That's kind of scary. Okay. PDF file is really the file, the format that Adobe Acrobat software uses. This is a PDF file. And this is a paper. Orlistat is a novel inhibitor of fatty acid synthase with anti-tumor activity from 2004 Cancer Research from La Jolla, California. Okay? So, you know, when I lived in California and I had patients from Oregon and I would make suggestions to those patients, the Oregonian doctors would say, he's from California. Now, when I'm up in Oregon, and I do the same thing with Oregonian patients, and well, he uses things that there's nothing to substantiate that. Everything that I'm telling you is based on literature that's published in peer-reviewed journals. This is not wild speculation on my part. It's based on reality, on biologic truth as we know it. So there are multiple papers. This is the journal of the American Association of Cancer Research, the journal called Cancer Research, highly respected. So here you have, from this group, a very important paper. And you also have this. Is what the issue in Insights on nutrition?
Yes, sir.
Thank you. And here, just folks, to convince you, I know that most of you are from the Show Me State, right? Harry Truman State. Obesity drug inhibits prostate tumor growth. March 15, 2004. The Burnham Institute's Jeffrey Smith, let me make that larger for you. Has discovered that orlistat, commonly prescribed as an anti-obesity drug, has a positive side effect. It inhibits cancer growth. Dr. Smith made this discovery using an activity-based proteomics screening technique developed in his laboratory that makes it possible to identify active targets and simultaneously screen for their inhibitors. And that's the article I just showed you. Here's the guy, just a young kid. Jeffrey Smith. What's so funny? Anyway, it's a prescription. You have to speak to your doctor about it. Maybe what I'll do is if Russ sends me an email, I'll send him the PDF file. I know Bill Blair already has a PDF file somewhere on his computer. But I know that Bill Blair is computer challenged.
Never. Difficult in my health.
I know also from your HMFs that most of you are computer challenged. And how I can tell, you don't know how to insert a row in a table. So I get all these rows that are all different sizes. You're creating all these different size rows. All it is a simple click of the mouse if you know what to click on. It's called insert row. Or delete row. So I'm still using a lot of the delete rows and reinserting the correct size row. Anyway, all right, so this was important. We already found the insights issue.
Okay, what was the date again?
December 1999.
This is another example of the value of the PCRI insights. We'll bring a stack of them to our next meeting, but you know, it's free and it's loaded with good knowledge. So you know, you really ought to get onto that and get that document. Okay.
Also, there's a chapter in the disease prevention and treatment book from Life Extension from 2003 that has 64 pages on prostate cancer. And part of it is all on nutrition. I just brought up part of it here. You can even do an internet web search for it by going to lefprostate.org. LEF for Life Extension Foundation, prostate, no spaces, .org. And this section, within the 64 pages, there's a section here on nutritional aspects of prostate cancer.
Goes in. Website.
Online.
You don't need the book. Online. You don't need the book.
They don't need the book. Do you have a copy of that book here?
No, I don't have it with me.
It's a big yellow 1,000-page book. You can get it from Life Extension. Usually you get it for free if you're a member. And it covers all of basically total health from head to toe. And it's got a lot of very well-written articles in it, very good chapters. And I've written the last two editions on prostate cancer. And the one from 2003 is probably one of the best pieces I've ever written, all 64 pages of it. I wish I would have published that in a medical journal instead of in the Life Extension book. But here you have all the things that you can see on the screen that are important, and they're discussed in detail. There's also lifestyle changes, but this goes all into detail within that chapter. There's even stuff on hereditary aspects. Okay.
What was that website?
lefprostate.org. And by the way, if you go to that website, their search tool is very, very nicely done. Type in anything in that little search box.
The next question related to some. What about silymarin and lactoferrin?
Okay. Lactoferrin. I'd have to go back to my papers on that. I haven't really kept up with that. That was old stuff that looked promising, and then I kind of not pay much attention to it. So I'm not really sharp on that. And the silymarin. Silymarin is basically an antioxidant that is derived from milk thistle that has anti-proliferative effects on prostate cancer. And there's certain subfractions of silymarin. There's a subfraction called isosilibin B that has significant anti-prostate cancer activity. The real big problem is, where do you find a source that contains a significant amount of isosilibin B? And where are the clinical papers in humans? Because the papers are really in human lines, cell lines of prostate cancer. We don't have any real great studies. So you don't all realize how important a part of the equation to the answers that you're asking you could be. Within us too, you could be doing a pilot trial of things like isosilibin B, a pilot trial to confirm the study on pomegranate juice, on doubling time, to confirm any of the things that I've mentioned in animal models of prostate cancer, or I'm sorry, in cell line models of prostate cancer. You could know within 6 months whether something was really valuable or not. You could be publishing that stuff as an empowered group. Do you know, how many members in us, too?
Total?
Yeah. 30,000?
Yeah, 35,000.
I mean, even if you had a study of 100 patients getting a particular supplement, if the protocol was cleanly done, then you could be making a huge contribution to yourself.
And we've talked about doing that with a couple of things recently, and in fact, we've talked about doing it on some with the help of Dr. Strum, too. A separate question, and these are related to genistein. What is your opinion about genistein and the amount that we should be taking? And then a sub-question was, do you recommend any supplements during radiation like genistein?
The major source of genistein is from soy products, probably mostly in terms of food, tofu. Okay, soy milk, forget it. It just doesn't have very much, and it's got a lot of sugar in it. Some companies make a soy supplement that's high in genistein. The Life Extension has a product called Ultra Soy that has got a significant amount of genistein in it. The real issue is that we have to confirm these clinical studies and cell lines that they actually work in human beings. This is very provocative stuff. It looks, genistein, by the way, looks to be an important player, and there's a derivative of genistein that's going to be considered a new drug that is a very hot topic in prostate cancer treatment. It's called phenoxidiol. Any of you heard of that? Phenoxidiol. Most of the studies originally coming out of Australia from a company called Novigen. And Dr. Stephen Tucker in Los Angeles, I understand, will become one of the principal investigators for phenoxidiol. Looks like it's a very active agent, and it's a derivative of genistein. And it may be possible that the activity of phenoxidiol or even genistein may be related to its effect on vitamin D metabolism. Maybe. This is speculation. Remember, genistein increases the enzyme that converts vitamin D3 to the active vitamin D and decreases the enzyme that breaks it down. So it leaves more bioactive 125 vitamin D up there to work against the prostate cancer.
There's a genistein trial, I think I mentioned to you last month. There's a genistein trial being done by Dr. Ray Bergen at Northwestern University, and it's a clinical trial, and it's still open to patients, so anybody that's interested in a clinical trial on genistein, let me know.
Let me also add, there was one trial published that was a negative trial somewhere, I think it was somewhere from the Midwest. I have it on my computer, but I don't want to look for it now, that didn't show any really major effect. You have to, again, look at all of these trials in the context of how they're being used. What was the dose? The doctor that's done most of the work on genistein is a guy named Hermann Alderkreutz from Austria, and he's actually shown the correlation between blood levels of genistein and actually effects biologically. In one of the papers I shared with Bill Blair, they actually showed that you had to achieve a blood level of genistein that was substantial, but that was able to be obtained by dietary intake. So when we docs come out with a paper that's a negative result, we also have to understand how are we giving the medication. To give you a good example of this, androgen deprivation therapy. The studies that are negative studies on combination therapy, many of those studies don't even bother to check testosterone levels. Many of those studies don't use undetectable PSA as the biologic endpoint. Some of those studies use PSA in patients with high Gleason scores, where other markers like PAP and CGA should be checked, because those high Gleason scores, remember, they have a low PSA leak, and the PSA becomes unreliable, not as useful. So everything in life is a two-edged sword. PSA is wonderful, but sometimes it's not. Some of these test results that are negative may be negative results because they didn't look at the full context of the situation of the patient. Here's the article on Life Extension. Okay, here's the title page. Reducing prostate cancer deaths. through prevention and early diagnosis, and that was the issue that the gentleman over here mentioned, and it goes into everything, including some of the PSA kinetics, and then it goes into diet over here. This is a PDF file, and any of these files, the rest that you want, if you don't have them, goes into lycopene, it goes into vitamin E, talks about foods that are rich in lycopene, talks about books to read. It even shows you a picture of your favorite vegetable, which is a good snack, by the way, for those of you who get the munchies while you're watching TV, asparagus or broccoli. So it goes into all of that and even has a picture, I think it has a picture, of the eicosanoid, yes, it has a picture of the eicosanoid pathway that I've been, when you blow it up, it loses part of its, but here's the arachidonic acid. It's going down into these metabolites that stimulate tumor growth, but that's not very sharp here, but it's very readable on the original paper. Are any of you reading Barry Sears' books on nutrition? Bill Buckman, the only one in the whole room? Any of you read The Anti-Inflammatory Zone? Bill Buckman? How come? Just a brief excursion away. We think that the food that we eat is to satisfy our sense of taste and pleasure. The food that we eat, I mean, this is the engine. The food that we eat is the fuel. Now, if you take your car to the gas station and you put a high-performance engine and fill it up with a gasoline of low octane, you're going to ruin your engine. You're going to ruin your engine with NOx, engine NOx, and with products of combustion that will coat your cylinders with carbon and other oxidative products, just like you do with your body when you don't eat properly. So you have to realize that what we put into our mouth and what we chew and assimilate is the fuel for our cells. Normal cells, healthy cells, and cancer cells. So all of you out there that are carbohydrate addicts, that are eating all the sugar and simple sugars, you're basically stimulating insulin, which also stimulates prostate cancer. You're also stimulating cardiovascular disease through this pathway by making this pathway more active over here. Sorry, this is blurry, but if you read the actual paper in Life Extension, it's very sharp. Activated by insulin. So here you have an omega-3 fatty acid that's at the crossroads of health. You can either go and make the wrong turn and go down the path of arachidonic acid, AA, arachidonic acid, activated by insulin, inhibited by fish oil, EPA and DHA. Okay? And glucagon is an antagonist of insulin. We don't give glucagon to patients. It's just something that we can't do technically, but we can certainly give you fish oil. We could normally give you fish if we didn't contaminate it with mercury and other products. But this pathway is inhibited. If it's not inhibited, it leads to all these products here and these pathways that are responsible for virtually every single illness that besets mankind. From neurodegenerative disease to arthritis to allergies to cancer to cardiovascular disease and stroke.
Again, what did you tell us a little while ago about how much fish oil? We got to get the right kind, but how much do you recommend?
I would remember to use a biologic endpoint, but I would start off, unless your diet is really healthy to begin with, I would start off with 3,000 milligrams total of EPA plus DHA. Just those two, pay attention to on the bottle. Where it says other omega-3 fatty acids, we don't know what that means right now. So when you relate your dosage, relate it based on what is your daily consumption of EPA plus DHA. And if you really want to be smart, get a baseline AA-EPA ratio through Mayo Clinic Laboratories. And that, if you're really healthy, that should be around 1.5. Now, if you're really healthy, You may be healthy nutritionally, but not with other aspects of your health, and you may still have active prostate cancer. But you've got to fine-tune the whole orchestra. That's one part of your orchestra. And then after you've been on the fish oil, after a month, 2 months, recheck the AA-EPA ratio and see if it's come down. From if you were high, see if it's come down. One of the nicest results I've seen with one of my patients, actually from Oregon, was that he had a value like 12. And he bumped up his fish oil and then overshot the ideal value and was down to 0.8. So we had to reduce his fish oil, and now he's almost perfect at around 1.5. So again, it's a happy medium. Too much fish oil isn't good. Too little, it's the Goldilocks phenomenon. Not too hot, not too cold, just right.
I have a question about tofu. Many of us cook it in like a stir fry. Is it stable? Get it done.
Okay. Is tofu stable? Yes. Is genistein stable? I don't know. This book over here, which is really a book for the more advanced prostate cancer patient, written by Kurzweil and Grossman, called Fantastic Voyage, goes into issues about cooking as part of this book and talks about how much better it is to do stir fry using a little bit of water, olive oil, and then using your tofu. I just finished reading that section, actually. But I don't know whether genistein is you don't want to get anything that you cook so hot that you're creating these aromatic compounds that are actually carcinogenic.
Yesterday you mentioned a simple carbohydrate for us to eat. Could you tell us what that is?
I don't remember that.
Okay.
What I would suggest is that the carbohydrates that you eat, and when you read books like this one, which goes into glycemic load, okay? Glycemic load is the concept that certain foods have a carbohydrate content, and that content, because of the nature of the carbohydrate, makes the carbohydrate more available rapidly to create insulin surges. And foods that are like simple sugars and starches and breads and pastas rapidly release their glucose molecule. They are broken down rapidly. They stimulate insulin, and that creates a lot of the problems with health. So what they're suggesting is when you do carbohydrate, find carbohydrates that are complex carbohydrates that take a while to be broken down. Then there's none of these insulin, big time insulin surges. So there's carbohydrate in a lot of vegetables, but you want to use the vegetables like the leafy ones, the spinach, the cabbage, the broccoli, the cauliflower, and not the ones that usually grow underground, which are higher in glycogen that are broken down rapidly into sugar.
Okay, change of subject. This one you may or may not be able to answer, but it's related to insurance, but it's also related to what we were talking about getting special tests. Most of us have Medicare and also have medical supplemental insurance. If a specialist charges you $300 for a visit and Medicare only pays $80, the rest is covered by your supplemental insurance.
Wrong.
So his question is, what's your experience in a similar situation?
The way that works, and this is one part of medicine that I truly hate, is the medical economics of medicine, is that if Medicare approves a particular treatment or a drug or a visit and says, you know something, I'm going to allow $100 for this visit. I don't know why they play this game. I think it's a stupid game. It's insulting. I'm going to allow $100, and the Medicare rule or equation is I'll pay 80% of what I allow. So I'm paying $80. That means that the 20% that I approved of but didn't allow is covered by your supplemental insurance, your ARP or your Prudential. So if Medicare says I'm allowing on the doctor's charge of $1 million, suppose that a doctor charged you $1 million for an office visit, and Medicare says, I'm sorry, it's only worth $50. And I'm going to pay you 80% of that, or $40, your supplemental insurance picks up the $10. That's it. If your doctor accepts Medicare, he gets if he's lucky, the full $50, if the secondary insurance company kicks in. That's how it works. No, is that clear?
The exception there is, if the doctor tells the patient ahead of time, I will not accept the Medicaid payment, then your Medicaid supplement many times will pay the whole amount the doctor is charging you. That's the point I wanted to bring up.
If the doctor is not a participating Medicare physician, if he's not, then you are responsible in terms of the contract that you make with that doctor. Medicare has no responsibility. Do you understand that? Because I think that you really have got it really wrong. If I say I'm not accepting Medicare, and in my practice, my subspecialty practice, now in Oregon, I don't bill any insurance. It's purely fee for service. My contract is between patient and me. Nothing to do with insurance. If you don't have a physician participating in Medicare, you can't go to Medicare and expect them to pay anything.
No, he simply says, I don't accept the Medicaid payment, the amount, the restriction on it. And if I communicate that to Blue Cross Blue Shield ahead of time, then at least there is one instance in my case they have accepted that. Like, for example, when I go to Mayo, the Medicaid does not pay the whole amount. But the part that the Medicaid did not cover, my Blue Cross Blue Shield paid the entire amount, the rest of it.
Okay. All right. We
That's
won't
what I wanted to bring up.
Okay. All right. Next.
Does ADT have any permanent deleterious effects on normal prostate cells?
Yes. ADT will, both normal prostate tissue and malignant prostate tissue, loves testosterone. In fact, every cell in the male body loves testosterone. Brain cells, bone cells, blood cells. Skin, everything. Bone, everything. There are androgen receptors in every single tissue of the human body. That is why when I first started using androgen deprivation therapy, subtraction therapy, I started to notice all kinds of problems in patients getting this therapy. Problems with anemia, which led to writing a paper called The Anemia of Androgen Deprivation. Problems with bone loss, that resulted in my focusing on bone integrity issues and blocking that. Problems with cognition, where people would have problems sometimes with simple mathematical formulas. Problems with depression, emotional lability, easy crying. Testosterone is probably the most important hormone in the male body. What we have to do as physicians is look for workarounds. The anemia of androgen deprivation is exquisitely sensitive to drugs like Procrit or Aranesp. Even little doses will correct that anemia. That was presented at the American Urologic Association many years ago by me. The bone issues are reversed to a large degree by the use of bisphosphonates and bone supplements. And then with the issues of cognition, we need to figure out ways to get around them. We need to use pro-cognitive type supplements, things like Cognitex from Life Extension, things like Ginkgo, things like Vinpocetin, which is actually in Cognitex. We were talking about this at lunch. What supplements can you use to make your mental processes sharper? There's a very good book called Smart Drugs. If you go on Life Extension website, you can just do a search on cognition, but maybe on brain or whatever, and you'll see a bunch of different articles that are written about neurologic function. Using your brain is important. Use it or lose it. Every single tissue of the human body, use it or lose it. Every muscle, every bone, your hearing, you know? You put someone in a cave with no light for most of their life, and they'll start to have atrophy of their retinal cells. So everything has to be used, and there are workarounds to some extent for most of the problems that we have with androgen deprivation.
Here's another one related to androgen deprivation. On intermittent hormone therapies, Olodex, Casodex, Proscar, at what time or PSA should one resume therapy? And is there a relationship to measuring the testosterone to indicate when to go back on?
So when a person is on androgen deprivation therapy and goes off, during the off phase, what is the trigger to go back on? Is that the question, in terms of PSA? That has to be put into the context of what the patient has been using as part of their androgen deprivation therapy. When we were using only two drugs, for example, Lupron and flutamide, our trigger in a patient that had an intact prostate gland was 5. Had a prostate gland, only two drugs, it was 5. When we went to 3 drugs with Proscar or Avodart, in addition to the other drugs, we lowered the trigger point to 2.5 because of the fact that Avodart or Proscar significantly would lower or reduce the PSA. In patients with a high Gleason score, I wouldn't rely totally on the PSA. I'd be looking at other markers. And we also learned that we've got to be checking the DRE, because sometimes the prostate cancer starts shutting down its manufacturing and secreting the PSA. So we had a few patients who looked like they were doing really well, but when we checked their digital rectal, we actually found tumor nodule. We don't want to find a tumor nodule on a DRE because that indicates significant volume, and that should have been treated even before it got to that level. We don't want a titanic phenomena where the iceberg, the subclinical disease, is now expressed to where we can feel it. That means a larger volume. Think of the ocean, an iceberg underneath it being subclinical disease, and that being tumor, okay? And if that grows to the point where we can now see it or feel it easily, that means that the volume has increased. I don't want that. I want to keep tumor volume down as low as I can, but try to balance that with the quality of life. That's the reason for the intermittent androgen deprivation. It was a logical expression of seeing the side effects of androgen deprivation and wanting to return testosterone because it's so important to the physiology of the healthy male. We also had literature from Vancouver, from the group up in Vancouver, that return of testosterone, that surge of testosterone, actually would have a pro-apoptotic effect on the cancer cell. Pro-apoptotic meaning that it would actually cause cell death by the surge of testosterone. Well, I think that that's interesting biologically, but for me, what I wanted was to take this gentleman's testosterone that was depleted and let it return up higher so that he could think better, his anemia would disappear, his muscle mass would come back, his osteoporosis would be less, he'd have interest in sex again if that was something he was interested in before. It's kind of like golf, all right? Could I play, Doc? Can I play golf after my surgery? Well, could you play before? So all of these things were important in terms of quality of life.
Why would you go back on so soon then? Because generally the testosterone doesn't rise anywhere near its normal when you only come up to like a 2 or 5 PSA.
I wouldn't agree with that. Okay, and the patients that we have on hormone blockade therapy, on ADT, when they go on to the off phase, their return of testosterone is dependent upon how long they've been on the ADT, their age, and their own innate nature in terms of how strong their testicular access is. There are some guys that you take them off of ADT, and in 2 or 3 months, their testosterone level is up there 200, 300, 400, or even higher. If you've been on ADT for a long time for me is over 2 years in a row, and if you're an older man, you may not have a return in testosterone for many, many months, if not years, if at all. So we try to limit the continuous duration, not the cumulative, but the continuous duration of ADT to a maximum of 2 years. Because we found that if you go beyond that, and if you're over the age of 72, that you may not have a return of testosterone. Why does that happen? The Lupron or Zoladex or Triptorelin or Trelstar works by sending a message to the receptors in the pituitary gland to stop producing LH. It's an LH-RH hormonal agonist that keeps on perturbing the receptor to where we think that receptor becomes defective. And if you keep doing that for a long enough time, that receptor doesn't recover, sometimes for years, if at all. So only in the setting of an older man whose hormonal axis is already starting to have changes due to age, with continued androgen deprivation, do we see real delayed return of testosterone. But for guys in their 40s, 50s, 60s, even 70s, a lot of them will come back within 3 months. Many of them will come back, I would say the majority will come back within 6 months, and probably 80% will come back within 8 or 9 months.
I guess part of the, and we have so many questions on this, that's why I'll raise one other one that comes up often, and you know, this big question is always, when do I go back on, when do I go off, and you've answered a number of them today with some specific answers. But let me ask the question, when you say go back on at 2, why? Do you know anything about the cancer? And that's another thing that we were talking about here, to try to get somebody to measure these biological markers to tell us to see if the tumor was starting to grow again. I mean, the same question that you raised before, the opposite side. What if the doc did a DRE and the prostate was still small and smooth and no nodules at all? Okay. That was about three questions, sorry.
Hey, first of all, thank you very much for re-asking that question, because you really raise an important issue. If you have no prostate, let's suppose you had a radical prostatectomy and you had recurrence and you were then put on androgen deprivation therapy. Are you all with me so far?
Yes.
And you did really well, and then you went on the off phase, we call it intermittent androgen deprivation, the off phase of ADT, and your PSA started to rise. Well, number one, you know that PSA is all malignancy related. So you had your prostate removed. Yes?
Right.
Okay? We know that PSA has a lot more meaning than the PSA in a man that has his prostate that just went on hormone blockade therapy and then went off. We don't know the qualitative nature of that PSA. We don't know if that's benign PSA or malignant PSA. So what do? How do we get clues? How do we get biologic inputs to the nature of that PSA? Anyone? Tell me. There are answers. Tell me.
Free PSA?
Thank you very much. Free PSA percentage is one clue. Hardly anyone does that. I mean, that will tell us whether or not this is likely to be malignant or not. Another clue.
Color Doppler.
Color Doppler ultrasound. Okay, another one. Come on.
Combinex.
No, that you're looking. Well,
I wasn't even thinking. I did. Let me think for a minute. Go ahead, answer it. Yeah.
You could use other markers, but in this setting, I think that probably, unless that was a marker that was abnormal to begin with. No, I'm looking for one thing that's very obvious. One thing that's very obvious.
Yeah, that's what I was just asking. Okay. I asked that before. The digital exam. What if it's still small and smooth?
Okay, but what if there's a nodule there? Okay, you don't want to throw away something that's inexpensive and easy to do and should be really relatively close to painless. Maybe a little bit uncomfortable, but nothing that's causing pain. And then you also have some of the tools that Dr. Behrens elegantly described. You have a metabolic assay of the tumor, a functional assay with MR spectroscopy, magnetic resonance spectroscopy, and you have an anatomic assay with magnetic resonance imaging. Do you know that when a man has prostate cancer and goes on androgen deprivation therapy, if you send him up to a facility that does magnetic resonance spectroscopy, he'll basically be wasting money doing MRS because metabolically that tumor goes into a state where it's just not doing anything. So the spectroscopy, the value of the spectroscopy is lost. Unless you had an androgen-independent cancer that was metabolically active, then it could be worthwhile. But for the most part, if I send a patient to San Francisco or to New York, and mostly it's been San Francisco because the docs in New York will only take their own patients, but I can send them up to UC San Francisco, if I send a patient there, and they've been on hormone blockade, spectroscopy is invariably shows nothing. It's valueless in 99.9% of the patients that I've sent there because I've metabolically shed off the tumor due to the lack of testosterone.
if you did, I don't think you've answered my question. If you did the finger test and it was small and it was smooth, and let's add one more caveat, that the guy's PSA had, sorry, testosterone hadn't risen.
Hadn't.
That enough of an indicator?
You said hadn't, but you raised your hand.
Oh, I'm sorry. If his testosterone had only come back to like half of what you'd want it to get to, and the finger test, the DRE showed small and smooth and no nodules, would you want to be putting him back, still putting him back on at 2 or 4, or would you leave it go longer to get that testosterone up?
Well, I'd be more concerned if the testosterone had come back up that much and the PSA was increasing, because testosterone will stimulate the PSA production in even normal prostate tissue. So if the PSA is coming up and the testosterone is only 30, that I'd be...
No, I meant like 200.
Sorry, not 30. I mean, not that it's staying way low. I mean, it's like 200, not 400.
Okay. The definition of testosterone recovery is a little bit tricky, okay? We got to get into context again. I would say that if you see a testosterone level coming up and it's getting up to 150, 200, you've got enough testosterone to drive PSA, okay? But the other thing that you should have mentioned was if the prostate DRE, if the DRE is smooth and size is reasonable and the free PSA percentage was 25% or higher, I'd be very happy with that PSA because I would feel that that PSA was benign related. And hardly anyone, Leibowitz, Tucker, even my former partner, Scholes, and Dr. Lamb, I don't think anyone other than when I was in practice and now routinely checks the free PSA percentage in that setting. They should, because that's a clue to whether or not you're, you know, there are some docs who don't want to restart the hormone blockade, like Bob Leibowitz, who feels that you can do that and stay off of it indefinitely and it will plateau. I want to know the nature of that PSA. So I don't know what, maybe Bob's doing that now, but I want to know what that PSA is that's come up. Should I worry or should I not worry? If the the free PSA percentage is high, over 25%, even if it's between over 15%, I'd feel a lot better in observing that patient than if it were 7 or 8 or 9 or 10% or anything less than 15. So get your clues. Be a good medical detective.
Does the value of THT play a role in the on-cycle for intermittent hormonal therapy?
Does the level of DHT, the metabolic, highly active product of testosterone that is created by the enzyme 5-alpha reductase, which is blocked by Avodart or Proscar, play a role in monitoring the patient? I don't think so, and I'll tell you why not. In the patients I put on hormone blockade for many, many years now, I'll routinely use a 5-alpha reductase inhibitor like Proscar or Avodart. Those drugs are so exquisitely effective in shutting down DHT that I would tell you that 99% of the time when I measure DHT levels, they will be very, very low. So I don't need a laboratory test. There are other drugs that are reliable that I will be able to reduce certain levels with such degree of consistency that I can almost sometimes feel comfortable in foregoing the laboratory test. Another example is Dostinex, lowering prolactin. If I get a patient on a decent dose of Dostinex, I'm almost invariably assured that I've suppressed the prolactin level down to 5 or less. Avodart, if I put them on 0.5 of Avodart, I have not seen a patient that, maybe there's one outlier, but not that I remember even, where I've ever seen the DHT level that has not been suppressed. Unless you have another example of that?
No.
Has anyone been on Avodart or Proscar here that had an elevated DHT level or even a high normal level?
How high?
Well, in the high, you know, the laboratories have different normal ranges. Now, John, was yours high normal on Avodart or Proscar?
Well, on Avodart, wouldn't get below 12.
And that was after being on Avodart for how long?
3 months, 4 months, 5 months.
Really?
Yeah.
Okay.
I've talked to several over the phone that have DHT up to 25 and above, low T. and taking post-care. Many of those, when they went to Amtrak, dropped right down. So look at the type 2 antibiotic when I took people.
But in John's case, Abadart, he still had a higher than desired DHT level.
Also,
yes. Yeah. But by the way, this raises some good points. If you are doing testing and looking at your biologic endpoints, and suppose you're on androgen deprivation therapy, and you've checked your testosterone and it's less than 20, and you've checked it, you don't need to keep doing that while you're on this over and over and over again. Either it's feast or famine. Either they don't check the testosterone at all, or the patient gets it every single time that they go to see the doctor. That's just wasting blood and a laboratory test and healthcare dollars. The same thing with PAP. Some of you get hear the word PAP and you think that you should get it every single time that you're tested. PAP has a lot of fluctuation when it's in the normal range of less than 3. If you get a PAP, get it before you go undergo treatment to see if that marker was elevated at baseline. Then, if you get a treatment, check the PAP, and if it goes down to normal, maybe recheck it one more time, but don't do it month after month after month. Because when you do that, if I'm your doctor, what you're making me do is enter stuff on your HMF over and over and over again. I'm wasting your money, my time, and your blood. You need biologic endpoints. You need markers of what you're doing, but you don't need a bang your head against the wall over and over and over again, right? It's like a guy checking his blood pressure and it's normal, and it's normal 2-3 times a day, and he keeps on doing that for the rest of his life. That makes no sense.
Okay, we got a question over here.
One question, in the case of
ADT is very well explained in the primer, yes.
Okay, question back here.
Yeah. In the case of a prostatectomy,
yeah.
And then subsequent to that is a rise in PSA, and there is an androgen deprivation treatment. You mentioned the fact that the PSA is the sole marker for the fact that actually there's definitely a malignancy. So if somebody goes...
And one second, let me just correct you. What I said was, to be perfectly precise, was that in the setting, in the context of a radical prostatectomy and a rising PSA, that PSA you'd have to attribute to active prostate cancer.
Correct.
Not that it was the only marker. You could have...
My question. I'm going to that, because then let's assume that you go to the particular deprivation androgen system and so forth, and then you stop after a particular period of time, when the PSA is at a particular level, whatever that is. Now, if the PSA rises again after 6 months, a year, or whatever, doesn't that PSA number become the main testing number, and all the other tests that we have been mentioning to people that did not have a prostatectomy, that makes those other tests redundant?
I would agree with you. I would agree with you. In the setting of we have a copy of the primer here? In the setting of prostatectomy or radiation therapy, where there's been PSA recurrence, if you look on page 148 of the primer, you will see that the results with intermittent therapy are spectacular, truly spectacular when you use 3 drugs. And that patient said that the patients were off therapy over 5 years, and actually beyond 5 years. The median, the 50% of the patients hadn't been reached at 5 years, so over 60 months. Do you all know how to look at those tables?
Was that being out of just 1 year?
That was being on, no, that's again fine-tuning. That was being undetectable for at least 1 year. Undetectable, defined as less than 0.05 PSA.
I see.
That most often totaled 16 months. The average time to get to undetectable in our practice, 4 months, 12 months at being undetectable. So at least 16 months of...
16 months on.
16 on.
Yeah.
So when you look at that... Oh, that's upside down. That doesn't help. When you look at that table... The x-axis is time off on the intermittent cycle, and in months, And if you go to the y-axis and look at the 50% of the patients, you'll see that for the three-drug regimen on page 148, that 50% mark hasn't been reached at over 60 months, 5 years. Meaning that if you have a PSA recurrence after surgery or radiation or both, and you go on three-drug therapy, measuring testosterone, going to undetectable and using that hypersensitive assay, and you fulfill the criteria, you've got years and years and years of off time, high quality life. While newer developments like vaccines are being developed, like active groups like you hopefully will evolve into, will get Provenge approved so that you can be even off longer.
Are there any, let's take the other side, do no harm, are there any disadvantages to staying on for 16 months repeatedly?
There's definitely a disadvantage to being on androgen deprivation therapy.
Well, other than the normal side effects, I meant permanent. Beyond the normal side effects.
So are there any significant side effects for being on and off? I'm not sure of you.
No, staying on for 12 plus 4 months.
I think that...
Does it get you to independent any sooner?
No, I think that last little phrase was the key phrase. Does androgen deprivation therapy cause androgen independent disease? I don't think so. I think that if you have a bad prostate cancer to begin with, that you have a what you would call a mixed bag of tumor cells, what we would call in medicine a heterogeneous population of tumor cells, some androgen dependent and some androgen independent. And why do I say this? If you take patients that present with high PSA and or high Gleason score that have bulky disease that's undergone mutation, those patients, much more than the patient that comes in with a PSA less than 10 and a Gleason score of 6 or 7, those patients will not get to undetectable PSA. They will not reach undetectable on homomolecule. This is something that is really important to relate to you because I've not been able to communicate it well to my colleagues in medicine. If you have a bunch of tumor cells that thrive on testosterone and you treat them with a therapy that deprives them of testosterone and those cells die, then their marker should die. And if you use a very sensitive marker like an ultrasensitive PSA, that marker should go way, way down, which it does. And 95% of men, at least 95% of men, newly diagnosed that go on ATT, you can get down to less than 0.05 on the average of 4 months. Leibowitz and Tucker, Scholes and Strum, Tisman, Myers, a whole bunch of us have seen that over and over again. If you have a patient with a more aggressive presentation, with a higher Gleason score, and you don't go down below that limbo threshold of 0.05 and stay there, you have androgen-independent disease probably, to begin with. So what we do in medicine in general is all these patients are lumped together. They're not distinguished from one another. So when the guys that have the more aggressive disease are on a hormone blockade therapy and their PSA is rising, the conclusion is the androgen deprivation therapy did it. Come on. Where's the good medical detective work? Do you see that? Do some of you see the obvious here? You know? You got a garden. I'll leave it to give you a metaphor. You've got a garden that's just pure dandelions, and you've got a great therapy called anti-dandelion therapy, ADT. Okay? Just turned out that the dandelion worked out in the ADT. And you sprinkle this on, and all the dandelions die away, and you're really happy, and you can even stop the therapy, and maybe you don't get any dandelions back for a long time. But the next door neighbor, okay, he's got a garden, but he's got dandelions and chickweed. And he uses the ADT therapy that knocks out only in real life, the androgen-dependent prostate cancer. But it leaves the androgen-independent prostate cancer. So what's the big surprise that over time you've knocked out all the dandelions but allowed the chickweed to grow? So what you're seeing really is the expression, the titanic phenomenon, the iceberg, expressing itself at above the beyond the subclinical level. Did I convert more of you into understanding what I'm saying?
Yeah. That's good.
Bill? Yes?
Why is in some cases the PSA will rise very rapidly in that situation, others very slow? Is there a difference in the antigen and the cell clones within themselves?
And I think the difference is that some of these clones are high Gleason scores that have very little PSA leak. A good case in point, I don't think he'll mind me discussing him, is Rick Maston, who I saw, and his PSA was something like 1.8, and they said, but Rick, you got a Gleason score of 10, you need other markers to assess your tumor cell population. You got some communist members of the Communist Party, you got some other bad apples in there that you need to figure out, are they there or not? Well, he did those tests, finally his oncologist agreed to it. His CEA, carcinoembryonic antigen, was 885. Normal level in a non-smoker is less than 2.5. Usually we don't get concerned if the CEA is less than 5. His was 885. Now, CEA can be expressed in colon cancer, lung cancer, stomach cancer. So we had Rick evaluated with a CT of the chest and with a colonoscopy and an upper endoscopy. I knew from previous experience that CEA is very commonly expressed in aggressive prostate cancer. So when we finally convinced his doctor to put Rick on chemotherapy, and he responded, guess what he responded to also? Not only his bone scan got better, but his CEA dramatically dropped down to less than 2.5. So there's an example of aggressive tumor cell clones making other markers, more radical markers, actually page 64 in the primer, without even looking at it, because I've referred this to so many times. If you go to page 64 in the primer, you'll see that as the Gleason score increases, the neuroendocrine, what are called neuroendocrine and aggressive markers, increase. Great Carmack does it again. Okay? All right? You can't see this, but if you want to pass it around, you can see that these other markers, CEA, chromogranin A, which is CGA, the other neuroendocrine marker, NSE. You know, a lot of the doctors will say, gee, I never heard of this stuff. There's lots of literature on this, lots of literature. Do you folks out there, I know that I'm not trying to convert you into physicians, but do you know how to use PubMed? Do you know what PubMed is? And as I was telling Russ and Bill earlier, it's not a bar in the Mediterranean. Do you know what PubMed is?
Yep.
How many of you don't know what PubMed is? Okay. PubMed is something that our tax dollars have paid for, and it's one of the most wonderful tools on the internet. It is, if you do a Google search on PubMed, just type in the word P-U-B-M-E-D, one word. It really stands for public medicine. It's one of the most important tools available free of charge in the universe, or at least in this galaxy. If you type in the word PubMed, you'll get to the screen. If we had an internet access, I would show you. And you'll get a very simple picture with a place where there's a search box where you can type in. You've got to click your cursor in there and type in. And if you typed in CGA, letter CGA, or if you spelled it out, chromogranin A, or typed in NSE, or PAP, or CEA, and then typed in prostate next to it, with a space in between the two, of course, it will pop up almost immediately with all the articles published in the vast majority of journals throughout the world for the last 15, 20 years, 20 to 25 years. And then if you click on that title that interests you, you'll see the abstract of that paper. So, for example, let me just find real quickly. Here's an example of an abstract, okay? And let me make this larger. An abstract of glycemic index, glycemic load, and risk of prostate cancer from 2004. So if you were to type in glycemic, the word glycemic, you don't even need index. and the word prostate in PubMed, you would get many articles, I don't know how many offhand, but you should be able to get this article by Augustine. These are the authors. Here's the title of the paper. International Journal of Cancer, volume number, page number, year 2004. And then if you clicked on that name in PubMed, you'd get this abstract. And you know something? Even the docs, even Strum, sometimes when I read an abstract, if I'm not real comfortable with the words, I'll have to read that abstract a number of times until I find some key things that sink into the old noggin. So don't get buffaloed by medical jargon. It's confusing. But you'll find that if you look at some of these articles, if you get a retrieval on PubMed of 5 or 10 articles, by the time that you get to the fifth article, and maybe the first 3 or 4, you've gotten 10%, a sense of 10% of what you've read. By the time you get to the fourth or fifth one, you'll start to understand what's going on. It's just like, you know, automotive terminology. So, just to give you an idea, dietary carbohydrates have different glycemic and insulinemic potentials depending on type, glycemic index, and amount, glycemic load, of carbohydrate consumed or both. Insulin, in turn, has been implicated as a risk factor for several cancers, including that of the prostate. So there's a study that goes into 1,000, no, the bold and the underlined is my stuff. I do that just to reinforce the things that I think are important. So here's a study of over 1,200 men, control patients, and they looked at the glycemic index and the overall risk for prostate cancer.
Steven?
We found direct relations between dietary glycemic index and load and prostate cancer risk. Do you have the internet on there?
I've got a bunch of papers on pomegranate and all sorts of things on here. But there's something else you can do as far as getting papers. When you go to PubMed, all you can get are the abstracts, which means you don't get the whole paper. You go to scholar.google.com, scholar.google.com. You can get the entire paper many times, the whole thing. You get everything. They'll let you search by year. They'll let you search by the author. You can search by certain keywords. We go to scholar, S-C-H-O-L-A-R, .google.com.
I use that one every day.
It's a great resource.
And what does it do?
Scholar.google.com will return everything in PDF format. It will return it in, you can search by year, a range of years, so we can look for every paper that's been published on pomegranate between 1960 and 2005 by a particular author, with certain words or excluding certain words. So anytime you want to know something, you can actually just type it in there and you can find papers. What's really interesting is, what?
Full document.
Yeah, the full document, everything.
Yeah, no cost.
No cost, it's free.
Instead of typing in the URL for PubMed, you just type in
scholar.google.com.
And it takes you to a different format where your retrieval is all in PDF format?
And you get the entire paper. Now you have to remember, this won't give you every paper in the universe. It'll only give you the papers that have been freely published. So there's plenty of papers on PubMed that you may not be able to access on scholar.google.com, but there's a lot of papers.
So you just provided an incredibly valuable piece of information that if you want to read the full paper, if you really want to be comprehensive, you do a scholar.google.com search with your keywords, and if you want to see what else is out there in abstract form, you just go to PubMed. God, that's a gold mine.
Yeah, you can. It's a good 1-2 punch there. Where you can get some information.
Other journals that they refer to that particular paper, so you know
it's okay. And really a key thing is, and thank you, John, a key thing is that if you print out that paper and you bring it to your doctor, your chance of him agreeing to that therapy or that whatever you're bringing to him is going to be a lot greater, because you're now bringing him something that his colleagues, his peers, have reviewed and published. Thank you.
That was very good. We've got one last question here, and then we just got one other subject that Stephen was going to talk for a few minutes on, but I'll stop the questions with this because it's a divergence. It's a very different question, and this is for people who are in consideration of proactive watchful waiting, and the question was, what kind of tests do you recommend to take periodically when you're on proactive watchful waiting?
Okay, when you're on active objectified surveillance, what kind of tests? Of course, I'd want to be doing a PSA, of course. I'd probably, almost certainly would want to do a, and by the way, anyone that wants to speak up and chime in, feel free to do so, because I'd rather have you answering your own question than me answering it. So, definitely PSA.
Free PSA, PAP, CEA?
Free PSA percentage, yes.
And PAP?
PAP only if, well, maybe not every single time that I test it, but maybe periodically. Remember, PAP can be elevated due to BPH also, to benign prostate hypertrophy. CEA, if my CEA, if I wanted to be, I would check CEA at baseline routinely if I had a Gleason score of 7, 8, or 8, 7, 8, 9, or 10 to make sure I didn't have an aggressive type. I want to know what my prostate cancer behavior or nature is. Okay, you know the concept of nature, yes? You know the story of the scorpion and the frog?
Yes.
All of you know that?
Yes.
Okay, the scorpion wanted to cross a river. And of course, the scorpion couldn't swim. So he went up to Mr. Frog, and Mr. Frog was about to cross the river. He said, "Mr. Frog, I'd like to cross the river. Can I hop on your back?" And the frog said, "No, I don't want to do that. You're a scorpion. You could sting me, and we'll die in the middle of the river. We'll drown." He said, "No, I won't. I want to cross the river too." So the frog said, "Okay, that's reasonable. Hop on." And he's swimming across his frog legs. I guess a frog stroke. And in the middle of the river, he feels a sharp pain in his back and realizes the scorpion has stung him and that both are going to die and drown in the river. And the frog looks up and says, "Why did you do that?" And the scorpion said, "I don't know, it's my nature." You know? So we have to really understand with anything that we're dealing with, be it social terrorism or cellular terrorism, the nature of what we're dealing with. We don't do that at all levels of society. And when it comes to biological phenomena like prostate cancer, we need to be checking that LED. We need to be checking that biology of that process. If you, one of the first good checks is a validated Gleason score by an expert like Bostwick or Bonkoff or Epstein, the David Grignon, but I think that the big guys that are doing this now are in the United States are Bostwick and Epstein are the major players for pathology. That validated Gleason score is your first major taste of, do I have a aggressive prostate cancer or do I have a garden variety prostate cancer? I want table wine prostate cancer. I don't want anything extraordinary. I want ordinary prostate cancer that has a doubling time of about 4 years. That's average garden variety prostate cancer. Diagnosis, most patients are diagnosed with a doubling time of 4 years. If I come up with a Gleason score of 4.3 or 4.4 or higher, I'm dealing with a more aggressive variant. Then I want to get more of a sense of the nature of that prostate cancer. I'll want to do the neuroendocrine markers. I'll want to do CEA, CGA, NSC, PAP. I'll want to be watching the doubling times of any of those markers that are abnormal. I may want to be doing free PSA and seeing if it's really low. I want to know, do I have, which is in a recent article in the Insights, do I have a turtle for prostate cancer? Do I have a rabbit? Or do I have a raven that's going to fly away and cause me early mortality? And that's what we need to do, is to look at this illness in the context of the various manifestations that it presents with. You do that, we know the nature of the enemy and how intelligently and appropriately to treat that. And some of the prostate cancers that we see, yes, we are over-treating. We can manage them with active objectified surveillance, with changing carbohydrate intake. Okay, any guys here that have a big belly, and I have a little bit more of a belly than I want to, I'm gonna soften myself a little bit in terms of my wife's a carbohydrate addict because she's all 95 pounds. But do you think it's easy to live with somebody that bakes bread in the middle of the day and you're smelling this great bread or brings home a chocolate cake from Costco, you know? So I have to be really, really careful. And sometimes I fall off the wagon and I'll do something.
You're human.
I'm human. But those of you out there, and this is not a condemnation of you in terms of your appearance, it's really, I'm looking at you as a biologist. Those of you that have a belly on you have really hyperinsulinemia due to carbohydrate overindulgence. And actually, this country will not have to worry about terrorism. If we continue to overeat, we will have so many diabetics in this country and so much vascular disease that Al-Qaeda and every other terrorist group can just send us cookies and cakes and kill us with hyperinsulinemia, which is, by the way, hyperinsulinemia is not only a major factor in cancer, but in cardiovascular disease and in neurodegenerative disease. It's a common denominator. How can my medical colleagues, a number of them, ignore the work of people like Sears and all the other spin-offs of Atkins? Now, where Atkins went astray was telling you to eat all the saturated fats you want, because that feeds cancer and doesn't help cardiovascular disease. So Atkins was brilliant, but he just needed to fine-tune his approach to lowering the glycemic load. You do that, you have a major jump start in prevention of all kinds of illnesses.
So these are baseline markers that you're talking about, CGA and so on. What
let me just interrupt you before you tell the rest of your question. Baseline markers, but I don't order them if I have a validated Gleason score of 6. And I won't even do them if it's a 3-4 with a little bit of 4. Because I know that having done this testing over and over again, that I very rarely find them elevated. Now, if the patient's medical story starts to change rapidly and there's some things that are not really behaving, if he's not behaving like garden variety or table wine prostate cancer, and I start seeing some things that bother me, I'll check those markers. In other words, I won't be so dogmatic that I don't check it, that I'll never check it. I'll hear the story and I'll reassess the situation. Now, the second part of your question was?
Any type of scans, either baseline or subsequent.
In the setting of surveillance?
Yes. Surveillance.
Remember, the bone scan is so crude and insensitive that until you reach high PSAs or high Gleason scores or both, your yield is almost negligible. That's been published over and over. And in fact, I'm an author with the docs from Holland on a paper, a meta-analysis on staging with the different imaging studies. So in the setting of surveillance, a bone scan, CAT scan, is so insensitive that a much higher resolution test is a PSA, a free PSA, even a digital rectal.
Call for the PSA.
What you would want to do, what I would want to do in a patient like that, is to start off with perhaps monthly testing to get the tempo. Is it, you know, it's like any of you musicians, you want to know what the tempo of the music is? Okay, is it halftime? Is it 4-4 time? I want to know, is that PSA really flat? Is that slope flat? If it's really flat and I've got 3 or 4 values, I'll start spacing it out to every 3 months, 4 months, 6 months. I'll probably be comfortable with no less monitoring than every 6 months.
And the PAP?
The PAP, I love the PAP, but I don't use it that much in the setting of surveillance. I really don't. Especially because in a surveillance setting, if I've selected you, for example, for surveillance, I've probably selected you because one of the reasons I've selected you was your PAP was less than 3. Now, let's suppose that you're really, less than 3 in the literature. So let's suppose that you are really a nervous guy and you say, hey, I got to get that PAP. I read about it and I heard about it. And if you get it and you've done it a couple of months in a row and it's fine, why keep doing it? I saw one HMF where every month there was a PAP. I saw some HMFs where every month there was a testosterone, even though it was normal. Now, some patients tell me that their insurance gets a little bit flabbergasted if you change the test that they order. So, in the year 1900, I ordered a PSA and PAP, and 1,000 years later, the insurance still wants me to order a PSA and a PAP. That's crazy. You have to challenge that. You don't need to be doing testing that's costing somebody, you or an insurance company, money, because you may need that revenue for appropriate testing.
About MRI, is it again, or
thank
color
you.
Doppler?
Okay.
Or with the color Doppler device, is it again, if you did it for?
Okay. On an active surveillance, if I've got a normal DRE and I've got a free PSA that's behaving and a PSA that's behaving, if I can get the patient into a free clinical trial at UC San Francisco where they're doing MRI and MRS as part of monitoring without charging you, I'll do that. But if they have to, you have to pay for that.
If you already did it, you need to do it again. How often?
If you've already done it and it's normal and everything else stays normal, I probably wouldn't do it, but I'd want to discuss it with the patient to make sure they weren't feeling super anxious. I mean, let's suppose you came in and saw me 5 years ago, and you had a Gleason score of 6, and a PSA of 4, and a T1C clinical stage, and you were not doing any antioxidants, you were not doing anything nutritious-wise, and I put you on a regimen, and you were doing fine, and your PSA basically was moving up by maybe 0.1 a year. Would I send you for an MRI, MRS after the baseline? No. If you told me, I'm really nervous, Dr. Strum, I really want this badly and I can afford it, would I do it? Yeah.
Okay.
And no color Doppler device either.
Color Doppler is helpful for a high Gleason, to picking up high Gleason score, but as part of surveillance, I don't think that I see any necessity for that.
Okay, we're going to have to stop here with the questions. There was one other topic just before we close that you reacted to our enthusiastic reaction to your recommendations last night, and specifically what I'm talking about is the issue of efficacy. And just before we close, are there a couple of other points that you wanted to make on things that we should or could be doing?
Okay. No, I was just looking through my list that I wrote up early this morning. You can. Yeah. Just a couple of quick things. Supplement companies, there are a number of them that I think are very reliable that I like. Just so you know, I am on the Scientific Advisory Board of Life Extension, so I do have some bias there. The reason I agreed to be on that advisory board was because I've been really utilizing Life Extension products for over a decade now. But I like besides Life Extension, Source Naturals is a good company. Source Naturals. I like Jarrow, J-A-R-R-O-W. I think Swanson's a good company, and I like Nordic Naturals. And I may have left out a few of the names.
What about Now? N-O-W.
I know that company, but I haven't had, I know of it, but I have not used that much to be able to make a statement one way or the other.
Thank you.
That's a very huge company, and I think that it may even be either, that may be a subsidiary of N-O-W or vice versa. A lot of these are big conglomerates. I don't know what to tell you on that either. I'm sorry, I plead ignorance on that. Laboratory testing. Some of you came up and told me that a PSA in your insurance is $190. That's outrageous. It's unheard of. It makes no sense. You could get laboratory testing done in almost any place in the United States through LabCorp or Quest Diagnostics or Life Extension, which uses LabCorp, at a very reasonable price. Nothing even remotely close to that. I mean, a PSA should cost really all of about $30 at the most. Mayo Clinic Laboratories is an excellent laboratory for the essential fatty acid profile. I would tell you that you should really look at Berkeley Heart Lab as a really avant-garde laboratory. I sent them an email before I left for Chicago asking them how could I get blood testing from patients around the country. They are subfractionating cholesterol into various types, and they're doing this enzyme test that Bill and I were looking at the meeting called PLA2, which looks to be very important in terms of not only heart disease, but very important for prostate cancer. Berkeley Heart Lab, I think, is BHL.com. Berkeley Heart Lab, BHL.com, or just do a Google search on Berkeley Heart Lab. They have some very nice literature on their website. Other good laboratory is Great Smokies Diagnostics. What's really missing for a lot of you who are on supplements, various vitamins, is the ability through your insurance or through your own pay to measure what you're taking. Like, I think we should know when we're taking vitamin D what our D3 levels are and what our 125 levels are. I think we should know if we're going to be doing genistein, can we even get close to a genistein level that is therapeutic? If we're going to be taking green tea, we should know that the active ingredient in green tea is called EGCG, epigallocatechingalate, EGCG, that you're hearing that on TV now. Okay, that's the active anti-cancer ingredient of green tea. You can measure that, and we should try to get Dr. Liao here in Chicago to measure that. Now, we want to know when we're taking green tea supplements, are we raising our green tea level, our EGCG levels? For those of you who like chocolate, although I will mention something that Russ told me, there's a company that makes chocolate with 100 milligrams of EGCG in each little piece of chocolate. That's the good news. And the good news also is that the chocolate is sugar-free, okay? But Russ told me that he looked at that and that the chocolate had a lot of saturated fat in it. I need to check on that because the chocolate actually tasted very good. And I'm a chocolate addict as well. So there is an ingredient in chocolate that is anti-prostate cancer, which at least that's what the literature says. It's called stearic acid. It's supposed to cause programmed cell death of prostate cancer cells, at least in the laboratory. That could be looked at in an S2 study. So I think that was something I wanted to relate to you. On the issue of advocacy, I think this is really the most important, really. I was saving it for last, but I think this is the most important aspect of what I can relate to you if I could ever convince you that the quotation from the Bible that is quite well known to a lot of you. I'm Jewish, okay, but for those of you who are Christian or Catholic, if you know the quotation where that goes like this, when two or more are gathered in my name, if you would realize the power of that quotation, you would realize the power of advocacy. Because our government officials get freaked out and terrified when they see a mass of patients, especially women, because the guys really are afraid of the women, because I guess they get hit on by their wives as well. But if you were to really, truly become sophisticated enough that no doctor could ever make you feel so insecure because of our use of jargon and terminology, that you as a group, even this smaller group, you could change the nature of medicine much more quickly than I can. When I went into medicine, I went into medicine because I couldn't stand politics. Knowing what I know now, I know that I've touched the lives of some people in this world, but I could have been hugely much more successful if I would have taken the same compassion and the same thinking and gone into politics. You as a group, if you go as a sophisticated group, if you can educate each other, help each other, really unite, and go as a group, you could probably get an audience, not with the Pope, but with Andy von Eschenbach, the head of NIH now, yes, that's what his, who is a prostate cancer survivor.
FDA.
Even more important. Andy von Eschenbach is a good guy. He's trained at MD Anderson, an excellent medical center. And we communicated with Andy when I was at the PCRI, and there was a question about whether he'd be appointed in the National Institute of Health. And we were ready, when I was at the medical director of PCRI, to unite all of the PCRI members to really write letters and send faxes and emails. Now, if you as a group, even a delegation, if you as a group here were to go and correspond or communicate with von Eschenbach, and say you want to meet with him and go there as sophisticated consumers, I think you would see fruits from your labor within a matter of a few months.
Signed by our group plus a few other signatures like that.
But you know something?
Signatures.
I think much more importantly, you the patient, you the consumer, you the client, you the patron, are much more important than my signature. Much more important. He is responsible to you. Much more. If I was a PC patient, yes. So get the doctors who are PC patients. But you, the non-MD patient, is much more important than me. So you have no idea, or you should have an idea now, that you could really affect the changes. You can get Provenge, which should have been approved as a relatively easy treatment, vaccine treatment. Maybe we could just use Provenge instead of hormone blockade therapy for PSA recurrence, or for even patients who are on surveillance. Maybe you only need two or three series of Provenge, a dendritic cell vaccine. I mean, we're using these things in advanced cancer. How can you use a vaccine in advanced cancer when the tumor burden and the immune system is suppressed? You want to use it when the tumor burden is minimal. So Provenge should have been approved. It will be, I think it will be approved within the next 6 or 12 months. But wouldn't it be cool, wouldn't it be really cool for you as a group to even expedite that and get that thrill, that surge of empowerment that you were able to actually activate this sooner and change lives quicker? So my Gene Dixon prediction is Provenge will be approved in the next 12 months, but you as a group, as a delegate, reading about Provenge in the primer, treatment on the horizon. I wrote about that with Donna Pagliano, my co-author, when we published this 3 years ago. Treatment on the horizon. Atrasentan, Zinlay, treatment on the horizon. FDA rejected that. Bill, did you keep that blurb from the Urology Times about atrasentan?
Sure did.
With
50% positive benefit. And the FDA usually approves 10% positive benefit, and the ODAC committee rejected it.
You have Provenge, you have Zinlay, which should have been approved. Mm. You've got Combidex, which is glaring. You've got a drug, a chemotherapy drug that's been approved for breast cancer, Abraxane. Now here's one that we presented, Bill and I, in Washington, D.C. You've got a drug called Abraxane, which is a nanoparticle. It's more nanotechnology, folks. This is, by the way, an important part of the future of medicine will be nanotechnology. Hopefully, we'll all be around, all of us will be around to see a lot of the major developments in this, but Combidex is a nanoparticle of iron oxide. Abraxane is a nanoparticle of Taxol. Okay, Taxol chemotherapy. It's a nanoparticle that goes more specifically into the tumor cell because it has receptors on it for that particular nanoparticle that's made up called Abraxane. It actually is so tiny, it gets into the blood vessel system of the tumor better. Even in patients who have been on Taxotere or Taxol, this variation of Taxol, Abraxane, is more effective and even can cause regression of cancer in those who have failed or progressed on ordinary Taxol or Taxotere. So what happens? The company that makes it gets it approved for breast cancer, but not for any other illnesses where Taxol or Taxotere is effective, including prostate cancer. And remember earlier on, in the beginning of the day, I said prostate and breast cancer are sister-brother disease. What works for one almost invariably works for the other. And it's been true for all the years that I've been watching both diseases. Abraxane, we've used Abraxane in a few patients with prostate cancer. Do you know that in Michigan, we can get Abraxane approved by Medicare, but not in Illinois? Do you know that in California, we can get Zometa for prostate cancer patients, but you can't apparently get it here?
Yes,
here
we go.
Oh, really?
Four times a year.
Four times a year? Okay, and in California, I could give Zometa to any man with prostate cancer. without osteoporosis. Does that make any sense to you that a federal insurance plan called Medicare should be different based on who the carrier is from state to state? Or even within the state, if you're in Northern California versus Southern California? Phenoxidile is just a derivative of genistein that should have been fast-tracked through the FDA and made available. It's already gotten fast-tracked for ovarian. Supposedly it's fast-tracked for prostate cancer, but yet there are no trials that are open. Results look really, really good. It's taken by mouth, no significant toxicity. Sitting there in the toolbox.
Steve, like you mentioned, the one reason it's not is from Australia.
Yeah, drug is from Australia. And that, you know, the most effective agent, I'll be with you in a second, the most effective agent in oncology today, and I've seen this now, when you've been around a long time, you see patterns recurring. Years ago, the first chemotherapy is roughly 1958 years ago, when a drug from Italy came out, from a company called Pharmatalia, called Adriamycin, because it was an antibiotic that came from the Adriatic Sea. It was the most impressive chemotherapy drug, and still is, for treating various cancers, prostate included, prostate and breast. And then we had another drug many years later called Platinum that came out, and originally everyone said, oh, it doesn't work for this, doesn't work for that, it's no good in lung cancer. It's one of the most active agents, many different cancers, including prostate cancer. And now recently, the taxanes from the yew tree came out, and the first taxane that was available came from France. And it's called Taxotere. But we couldn't get it. For years, we had the literature, but we couldn't get it. Instead, we had to use Taxol, which came from Bristol-Myers. Mm-hmm. I'm a stockholder of Bristol-Myers, by the way. So I'll need to let you know that. But I was ticked off that I could not get Taxotere from my patients because it was more active and it was less toxic. So there's politics here. And we should be like that movie, what was it called, Network? I'm madder than hell and I won't take any more of this. That's what I'd love to see with you guys, because that's what the AIDS patients should have taught us. They taught us to speak up and squeak. Squeal, scream, yell, shout, march, protest. And if you do that, these agents will be forthcoming. I mean, we should have all these available. You should have Abraxane available to you, Combidex, Provenj, Atrasentan or Zinlay, Phenoxidile. And one thing that Bill and I mentioned, and maybe you might want to make that PowerPoint presentation available, because we had even the speaker's notes on that. Why not have a delegate of sophisticated people here? Yes, that's the one. You already have it there. We should make that available. The presentation was called The End of Prostate Cancer. That's the most important presentation of my entire life in medicine in Washington, D.C., back in June. And it really dealt all with this issue of efficacy. Why not present to the FDA, but more than present, request firmly, which is also could be called demand, request firmly, assertively, a semi-approval process, meaning that if there's a drug out there or a device or a technique where there's literature showing efficacy for an illness as significant as prostate cancer, why not have a status that's called semi-approval that enables the pharmaceutical company not to go bankrupt, like the one that makes Combidex is a little teeny company called ABM, Advanced Magnetics. I'm afraid that company is going to go bankrupt while they're waiting years to get their contrast approved. Why not have a semi-approval status that allows that company to dispense that product or that drug with the data from those patients being demanded or mandated that it be collected and reviewed by an independent group of people, including patients, including delegates, to make sure it's safe, efficacious, where the therapeutic index is high and the adverse effects are low. And then if it is effective, grant it full approval. If it's not effective, take away its semi-approval status. And if it's questionable, continue with the semi-approval status. That's what the AIDS patients did. They got their anti-HIV drugs on a semi-approval status, and when they saw that patients were being kept out of the hospital and staying alive longer, those drugs were eventually given full approval status. What's wrong with that concept? But you also have to be responsible and not be selfish with what we're seeing in America. Americans are the most litigious people on the planet. No other country sues as much as Americans sue. I'm suing McDonald's because I eat their hamburgers and I got fat. I spilled the hot coffee on my lap, I'm suing them. I took PC spaz without my doctor's knowledge and no advice, and I got breast enlargement. Well, it's an estrogen. What do you expect? You know? I'm suing them. I'm suing them because my testosterone went down, and even though I'm 80 years old, I can't have sex with my wife anymore because I can't get a good erection. And the company settled for that. The company went out of business. Now, that's a different issue because there were contaminants in that product, but even with the contaminants, it was better than DES. But part of this in my approval process also relates to your responsibility. You have got to agree with a panel of attorneys that you're not going to sue these companies trying to get their products on the market if you have an adverse effect, because that's part of life. Every treatment we give is a two-edged sword. I've taken some antibiotics that I've had horrendous reactions to, and I say, how come I'm the doctor, I shouldn't have these, my patients should have these, I shouldn't have these, but I'm very sensitive to a lot of different drugs in terms of side effects. Should I turn around and sue every company? You watch TV, if you've had this drug or that drug, call this attorney. So part of this has to be your own responsibility that you want to further knowledge and intelligence and make available new therapies on a more timely basis. What is wrong with this approach? It is so logical. I mean, we should be able to get things approved much more rapidly. Just remember one thing. The FDA has never forgotten the thalidomide story. They approved a hypnotic, a sleeping pill, for pregnant women, which is, first of all, a woman carrying a baby shouldn't be exposed to anything other than good nutrition, you know, certain vitamins that protect the fetus. There shouldn't be any issue like that, but they were burnt so badly by that thalidomide causing the fibromyalgia, the small limbs, due to its anti-angiogenesis effects, that they've never recovered that. So they think that they're the watchguard for you. They're not. They're not supposed to reject these agents. They're supposed to give guidance on these drugs and these devices. But you need to be part of that process.
We've got five more minutes. Things would you like to...
Well, I think that it really comes down to the philosophy, the statement of Mahatma Gandhi. You are the change you wish to see in the world. All the years that I've been in medicine, it's come down really to philosophy. It doesn't come down to individual journal articles or this drug or that drug or the fixation on a treatment. It comes down to human interaction. It comes down to the word humanity reflecting human unity. It comes down to the two of you working together, or you getting to know this guy and helping him and him helping you. It comes to John and Russ and me helping Bill Blair get through his challenge with his prostate cancer, and then he gets back to me and gets in my case that I should be writing up my HMF for my problems that I have with arthritis and other conditions. You know, some things that for me are serious. And maybe I'll have another challenge later on. But we have to learn that the salvation of human life, of all life on this planet, relates to our interaction with each other. We have to be much more interactive and realize that we are linked together. You are my brother, okay? And vice versa. And you are my sister. And if I help you change your life, that makes me feel good. That's the old Ralph Waldo Emerson thing that Bill Buckman and I used to send back and forth. To leave the world a better place, buy a garden patch, a redeemed social condition, to hear a child's laughter, to know that a life has lived better because of your actions, that's success. That's what we should be aiming for.
Thank you.
think that's an excellent place to close it. And I'm sure that you've all received such a wide variety and outstanding information. And maybe more importantly, the close-up and personal exposure to our friend there, Dr. Strum, which is maybe the most important thing that we got out of the last 2 days. But again, I think we really need to thank Dr. Strum with one more round of applause.
Thank you.